Thank you, and thank you for inviting me to speak today. I've been at Lubrizol for about 28 years, and I had a great opportunity to go to China. So I'd be glad to be able to share that opportunity with you and some of the insights. So how many has actually traveled to China or Asia or would like to? Okay. And then what about for maybe for the people that, how would you like to work overseas? Anybody interested in working overseas? Okay. So what I'm going to try to share with you is what it was like to do business in China, and also a little bit more about what it was like to live and work in China as well. And actually, this I was in a city called Zhuhai, and this is the Zhuhai Fisher Girl, which is kind of the landmark of Zhuhai. So if you search Zhuhai, you'll see this Fisher Girl. So let me ask first of all, also, how many of you know about Lubrizol? Right, everybody knows about Lubrizol. So I don't need to go into too much about that. But you know, Lubrizol is part of Berkshire Hathaway, and we're located just down the street in Wycliffe, our corporate headquarters. And there's three business units that we have for Lubrizol. And what I've circled is the area that I was working in terms of building for the additive side of the business. We all have also have an advanced materials as well as an oil field solutions. So under the additives part, this is primarily engine additives, driveline, so things for your car, for your moving vehicles, the lubricants for that. And you can see the three bullets here about how do we want to grow our business and help develop that business. One is having products that meet that performance. The other one is testing. That's actually a competitive advantage that we have with the technology, be able to test it. And also then helping our customers differentiate. Well, in the North, probably North America as well as European markets, the additives is pretty much flat. We didn't see a lot of growth there. But we identified China as being a key area. But in order to be able to do these three bullets, there were certain things that we had to do. So if I show you what we had at the time in terms of a laboratory, we have our Wycliffe headquarters, our big lab, research lab there. We also have labs in the UK. And then what I have here for India and Japan, those were small labs. Japan was focused on servicing Japanese customers, and India was a joint venture, so that was a little bit locked in as well. And you see we have a gap here then. How do we actually grow in China if we don't have a lab or a plant in China? And so the goal then was to try and get a lab set up to really then be able to support the business, have a presence in China to be able to then be able to take our technology forward. So what I was chartered with, which is part of the story of what I'll tell you, share with you today, is really to be able to put the lab capabilities in so that we could do what we call local product customization. But there are three parts to this. The first one is a QA, because we're building a plant at the time. So I also had a QA lab that I needed to set up. The tech service part was then being able to immediately address customer issues, right? Tech service, they've got a problem with a product. We have a lab there in local time to be able to address that. And then this was kind of more of a stretch goal of saying, okay, if we actually start developing things, we're moving things more from a research standpoint, how do we get that in place? And what I'll show you with some of these numbers is that you'll see how this lab was growing as we tried to do some of this. At one point, once I had gotten the QA labs pretty well established, I turned that back over to operations and I was able to let go of that. So you can see I had three divisions. I think I had five bosses at one point. So trying to manage all of that was pretty challenging. All right, so just to get you oriented with the geography, Zhuhai is in the southern part of China. It's in Guangdong province. And it's actually across the bay from Hong Kong. So typically when I flew, I would fly into Hong Kong and then take the boat across the bay. And then this is a map of Zhuhai. And you'll see it's just north of Macau. You can actually walk across the border. Downtown Zhuhai's here. My apartment's where this river bent. There's a little crook here. And then we had a temporary lab set up at the Zhuhai College of Jilin University while we were building our plant in the R&D lab here in Gaolin Port. This was an economic zone that the government had identified to be able to grow and really bring in businesses and help that area. So travel time from my apartment, you can see it's crossing this river delta, probably took about 50 minutes, and it's probably about 30 to 40 miles. The challenge was that if they were doing bridge construction, traffic would just block up on any of these bridges. All right, so year of the dragon. This is similar to what you see on your Chinese menus. 2012 was when I went over there. How many people, anybody born in the year of the dragon? probably. Okay. So when I got there in April, we had the temporary lab set up. Someone had gone over earlier to get a few things set up. So we had two rooms at this university, which we had started setting up equipment. And what I'll show with some of these numbers, which I won't go into detail, was schedulable tests were the actual number of tests that we had set up that we could run. And the number of tests performed and samples blended was what the lab was doing and able to run multiple times. So you can see, pretty small. We were mostly focused on doing what we call used oil analysis testing. And then in terms of the number of employees, very small group. I had 7 on the tech service, had just hired the supervisor at that time to help me with recruiting. And then as part of the agreement at the university, we had 4 students, because we had the space for free, but we had an agreement that we would employ students as part of their, you know, internship and things like that.
Can I just ask, most of the people were from China, or
yes,
you brought people in
with you? I was the only one that was from outside, yeah. All right, so another team member was my driver, because I wasn't allowed to drive in China. It was a liability, and also with the way they drove, it probably was good. So in the 4 years that I was there, I actually had 4 different drivers. It's a little weird, because this guy comes in the morning, picks you up, takes you into work, and then he sits and waits until you're ready to go back to your apartment, and then take you back home, right? I don't even take my husband shopping with me. So to adjust to having this guy sitting around waiting for you the whole day while you're doing what you need to do, it's kind of an adjustment. Plus, if you need to go out, you know, to a restaurant in the evening with customers, or you need to go grocery shopping on the weekend, they're there to take you to do these errands. So not a lot of privacy in terms of what your schedule looks like, because they know where you're going and what you're doing. But also then you spend a lot of time with them. I mean, 50 minutes both ways, almost 2 hours in the car with them. I probably spent more time with these guys than I did with my husband, because my husband stayed in the US during my time in China. But you do develop a friendship. And actually, this is my last driver and my first driver. On my last day in Zhuhai, they wanted to send me off. And so you keep a friendship. Now, the other thing is, they didn't speak any English. So let me talk a little bit about not speaking the language. So I grew up with Cantonese. My parents had left China in 1957, so they brought me up speaking Cantonese. But it's what I would call kid level. I mean, that's all I interacted with them on. So I didn't have any technical terms or any business terms with that. And then you can see the different dialects that we have in China. Now, Mandarin is the written and the spoken dialect, right? So everybody at work can speak Mandarin, also probably one of their own dialects, as well as English. And they can switch pretty well between all 3 of them. And it's very humbling when I have to sit there and wait for them to translate something, because my Mandarin and my Cantonese were pretty small. Now, when it came to being outside of work, I think with my Cantonese, I was able to muddle through grocery shopping, things like that. I did sell someone. I somehow managed to get VIP status at a grocery store. I think I only understood about 75% of what this woman was telling me to sign up for. So another story with in terms of the language was, I lived in the hotel for the first month. And you're at a hotel, you're going to have someone that's able to speak English. Well, when I moved into my apartment, I realized that no one around me was going to have any English. And I managed, on the second day that I was in my apartment, to actually lock myself out. So here I was in shorts and a t-shirt, going, oh, you know what, saying, now what do I do? So then I'm trying to think of all the words I knew in Mandarin related to key and lock and all that. Ran downstairs, found a security guy, and the first thing I said in Mandarin was, do you have anybody that speaks Cantonese? Because I was more fluent in Cantonese. He radioed on somebody, and I think at that point I had about 6 security guards coming to see who is this crazy person that managed to lock themselves out of their apartment and is living in China and doesn't speak the language. But we managed to get me back into the apartment, probably about after 20 seconds of a locksmith and 200 RMB, so you divide by 6, for just get me back into my apartment. So I did take Mandarin lessons. I took that for about 3 years. It's a lot of memorization, but I also wanted to be able to read and write some of the characters, because you figure street signs and also stores, it's all in characters. So I wanted to at least have a sense of what some of the characters meant. But it's a lot of memorization. And so during my last year there, I just kind of said, you know what, this is too much time, and I had to table my lessons for a while. But the nice thing was, I think I could understand enough of what the lab was talking about. So they kind of said, oh, she does know what we're talking about. We can't just speak in Mandarin and she won't understand. So I kept them on their toes. So just some guidance about if you're communicating, again, when it comes to a second language, you know, your English, be concise and clear. Avoid those idioms and sports slang, because I'd have senior leaders come over and they say, oh, we're going to hit a home run, or we're 10 yards to the touchdown. And like, sports analogies, they don't follow football or, you know, baseball like that. Also, I find that changing topics too quickly, because it takes time to translate and understand. So if you start talking about this and then you move over to another topic, you sometimes find you have to repeat yourself so that they can register and translate. The other thing I found too was a challenge was if you're getting translation when you're doing a presentation. Because a lot of times you have your flow, right? You're doing a presentation or a lecture and you have a flow, but you have to stop yourself in order for that person to translate. And so you have to really practice that in order to get ready. And I'll talk a little bit more about interviews later. When we had issues, especially with construction, about, you know, how much the ductwork or airflow should be, there was a lot of debate. And a lot of times, all the Westerner was to say, talk in your native tongue, work it out, and then when it comes to decision, translate for us what the options are and what the decision needs to be made. Because it was too hard to have them to try and translate it during that whole discussion, or if there was a heated debate. And then the other guidance is just don't assume. Even though someone's English is very good, you'll find out that sometimes the comprehension isn't always there. So the key is to try and make sure that you can restate it or even use more simple vocabulary. So say it one way and then find some other words to say it another way. So my second week there, we had a very interesting ceremony. This was our groundbreaking for the lab. And it had to be at the auspicious time of 11:08. 8's a very lucky number, on April 8th, which happened to be our Easter Sunday. And so what we did here was we actually have offerings of food. This guy's bowing 3 times with incense, and each one of us did that. And then we, after the ceremony, then we also lit a string of firecrackers on this backhoe to ward off the evil construction spirits. So that was a very key ceremony in order to, before we could break ground. All right, so I mentioned that I had moved into an apartment. So this is where I was living. It was actually on the 22nd floor of a high rise. And what you could see, this is my front door, and there was like a little atrium area here. And I only had a washer. I had no dryer. So you can see my wash hanging here. And then the challenge was for how do I handle my sheets. So this is how I handled my sheets. I hung them out on chairs in front of the air conditioner. An option would have been to go up to the top of the floor, which was like 30th, and hang my sheets outside. But then I wasn't sure about the air quality and what kind of debris I would get from that. So I did this all inside. It took like a weekend to get my sheets dried. And then my kitchen had a gas range. What's under here is actually my microwave. I didn't have an oven. And then this unit here is actually a disinfecting unit. It's not a dishwasher. But what you do is you wash and dry your dishes, and then you put them into the disinfecting unit, and then it irradiates it and further disinfects. Another thing to note, I had to boil all my tap water before I drank it. So that was key, that I had a system for boil the water, let it cool, and then filter it. Also, I was warned by all the locals, you know, peel and pare your fruits. Don't eat anything that you can't do that to. So she said, avoid eating berries or something that you can't peel. And then also with the vegetables, in terms of the pesticides and the fertilizers, pre-soak and make sure you don't eat anything raw. So that's one of the things I missed, was eating salads. And I think I've been eating salads for about 8 months now since I've been back, because I missed my salads. Now here's the meat counter. Hopefully people are not too disgusted and they're not eating lunch. But this was a meat counter. So there's no USDA inspection. There's no date stamped on these meats. So I avoided that. I think it was just something I wasn't comfortable with getting into. And then I really could not handle getting my own chicken. So I left that alone. I ate a lot of eggs. But you notice the eggs aren't refrigerated. So that's another interesting difference. All right. So by August, you can see we're making progress on the construction. What I like about this photo is she's carrying an umbrella. So we're in Zhuhai, which is very tropical, so the sun's very hot. So how many of you like the weather that we had this summer? Yeah, okay. Zhuhai weather is like that. I mean, what we had during the day was probably what we would get early in the morning. It's hot and muggy. But in China, also, how many people like to get a tan? All right, everybody got a tan this summer, right? Well, in China, white skin is viewed as beautiful. So all the women carry an umbrella to avoid getting a tan. Now, I went running outside. Mike knows that I like to run. So as I was running that year, I had both men and women come up to me and say, "You're getting a little too dark for Chinese standards." I'm like, sorry. But that they would not be afraid to tell me that I was getting too tan. So, all right. Let me talk a little bit about working with the local authorities, because that was something we found during construction that's very critical to make sure that you had those relationships with the authorities that are managing the water, the electricity, the gas lines, the utilities, the roads, all that. And so the senior guys really did a lot of these banquets. They also, you know, involved with drinking and toasting during these banquets. Sometimes they turned into drinking games. The guy that actually manages our local authority relationship, I think one of his skills is that he can drink a lot. But we noticed that with President Xi coming on board and trying to eliminate some of the corruption, the number of banquets that we had actually dropped off quite a bit. So it's kind of nice that those things are probably being eliminated. And when it comes to gifts and favors, that's another one, because Lubrizol has a very strong ethics policy about not giving gifts more than $25. We had to report it. And especially if you're considering anything for government officials, you had to make sure it got cleared through senior management. And that's one of the challenges, because with the Chinese culture in the government, it's about doing favors or providing some sort of gift. And our sales guys have sometimes said, well, it's a challenge when our competitors are able to do that type of business, but we're trying to make sure that we stick to our ethics policy. So that's something to make sure that you are managing. Now, another thing I see from an impact is the government control. So with social media, instead of Facebook, they use something called WeChat, but it's monitored. Instead of YouTube, they use something called Youku, which is also monitored. And then instead of Google, they have Baidu, which is a search engine, which is also monitored. So they have their own, these are banned, but then they have their own equivalents. And then the other thing, when I was watching news, first time in the hotel, it's like, oh, TV went dark. I was watching CNN. TV broke, right? Blacked out. And that's how they shut off the news. And then in my apartment, I was close enough to Hong Kong that I could get a local station. So I'm watching, and remember when they had the Occupy Central in Hong Kong, and there was lots of news on that? When it got to China, got to that story, all of a sudden my TV would go to this commercial. And they play the commercial like two or three times, and then it'd go back to the news, and it'd be in the middle of the next story. So it's kind of weird, because we're used to getting everything and nothing's blocked. But the government, there's someone monitoring it, and they either blank out the TV or they'll run a commercial so that you don't get the news or the information. And then the air quality reports. This one actually, so in the cities, there's an app that reports the air quality. And I'll show you with Shanghai, they have the city average, which the government probably is involved with. And then US consulate would also report a number. And you see the difference between Shanghai, the city average, and the US consulate, 68 versus 51, almost double by the US numbers, right? Because the US is trying to report them more accurately. Well, Beijing, they actually blocked it, because the difference was so great. And Beijing was having lots of air problems. This is my husband up there in December. We went up. And it was a sunny day in another part of the city, but it actually looks like a cloudy Cleveland day, because it's just so hazy because of the air quality issues. So that was another one that's like, they actually just said it's being censored. And then talking about recruiting, I think what you'll notice with the resumes, a lot of job hopping. I think the rate of progress was so fast that people would job hop you'll see maybe 2 to 3 years in a location before they move to another location or another position. And it's really because there was a growth, and they would actually do that as a way to get more, you know, increase their pay. And then I also found that titles don't necessarily match their skills and experience. So when I was recruiting for a lab supervisor, they probably had less experience than maybe someone in the U.S. that probably has done more in terms of like managing projects or being able to conduct a meeting. And so that was another recalibration that titles don't always reflect what they're actually doing or capable of doing. As I mentioned with the interviewing, again, you need to allow time for translation. We did a phone interview, and I remember the person's English was pretty good. But when I asked the question in my American accent, the person on the line's like, huh, what's the question? And the person that I was there with, she was Chinese, and she said the same thing in English, but she had a Chinese accent. As soon as she said the same words, the person goes, oh, okay, I understand. So recognize that the way they're taught, they're used to hearing English with a Chinese accent. It dawned on me that. But then it's just different as to how they were brought up with learning the language, right? So be allowing for that. And then also, I think, some cultural difference with body language. Remember interviewing someone that could not look me in the eye. And you're used to when you do that, you have face-to-face eye contact. But no eye contact is actually considered a sign of respect. So don't judge a person for that. Actually, the person that we hired that was not looking at me turned out to be one of our strongest chemists. So we ended the year. This was December. You can see we've actually been adding more people to the group. So that's where our recruiting efforts were coming in. And you can see the lab starting to grow. This photo was actually running a 10K. They have a Zhuhai half marathon and 10K in December. I wanted to run it, right? Who wants to run a race in a foreign country? But the sign-on was all in Chinese. So I asked a coworker to help me with registering. And they said, oh, you're running this. I've never run a race before. Be happy to join you. So I got two guys in the lab to join me for this race. And that was when I realized, OK, sports attire is not universal. Because when we were running this 10K, there are people dressed like what you're wearing now running this 10K. So dress shoes, a button-down shirt, leather belt, you know, loafers, jogging along there. So that was interesting. I wish I had taken my camera, but I didn't want to be saddled with a camera at the time. All right, so next year is the year of the snake. Do we have any snakes? Oh, one snake, okay. And so you can see the lab is now starting to look more like a building. And that year was the first year I actually spent Chinese New Year in China. And one of the big traditions is that the companies will have what they call an annual dinner. So it's like a big banquet for the employees. And it turns into also a talent show. So each department employees will put together a skit. They'll either sing, dance, they might do jokes. They rent elaborate costumes. It's their opportunity to have some fun and also show what they can do outside of work. And also then management has to do their share. So here I am singing with the facility leader some song in Chinese.
All right. Would you mind singing it now?
No. All right, so let me tell you a little bit also about the Chinese holiday calendar, because that's one that's very different. So this year, Chinese New Year's fell on a Monday, and then New Year's Eve was on a Sunday. So the government declares Sunday, New Year's Eve through Saturday as holiday, and they say you get 7 days. But they say, because you have such a long holiday, we're going to declare the Saturday before and the Sunday after as work days. So you actually have a 6-day work week before and after your holiday. So that was one where they were saying, oh, we have 7 days. But I said, wait a minute, you're counting a normal weekend day as a holiday. I don't think that's quite valid in the US. And then you also have these makeup work days. So really, to me, it really truncates it. But that's one thing that is different. I can't imagine us trying to be able to institute something like that here in the States. Now, also a key tradition after Chinese New Year, especially during that first week that you go back, there's something called the hongbao or red envelopes. And tradition is that for adults is to put money in these envelopes and give them to kids as a way to promote prosperity in the new year. Well, in southern China, there's also this culture of it's married people that have to give it to single people. And also at work, then the bosses give it to the employees. So you figure a single person is going to make out like a bandit, and everybody would travel around to your office saying "Gong Xi Fa Chai" or "Happy New Year," and then you'd have to give them an envelope, and usually put in about 10 or 20 RMB. So divide by six, like $1 or $2, but it can add up. And the employees would actually show all the envelopes that they had, and they'd also target who just got married so they can go and get an envelope from them. All right, so when it comes to construction, you have your normal typical delays and things like that. But one of the things I think is a little bit different is in terms of aesthetics, in terms of considering that. A lot of times they'll put, in a room, then you'll have a pipe in the middle of it, or along a sidewalk, you'll see a pipe in the middle of it. Workflows, those things, and also some of the long-term impacts. And what I show here is that this was a fire extinguishing system. I walked in and said, what's going on? This should be up near the ceiling because I'm planning to use this as a two-level storage space. I can't have this pipe in the middle of it. Oh, it's too much work. I said, no. Long term, you're going to have to move it anyway, so move it now while you can. So the key is you really have to keep on top of it because where they place things, they don't always think about that, especially if you have a long-term plan. And then also, I'll show you what we had to do to be flexible and creative. Also experienced some worker strikes, again, because we had contracted out this level and then they subcontract. And a lot of times the subcontractors were not paying the workers. And so they were demanding payment. So they blocked the traffic to the construction site. I know the guys went out to the bank and just withdrew loads of cash and then handed it out in order to pay them and clear the space. These guys were also staging a sit-in at another point. And we had to pass through some of this sometimes. And then also, we have snow days here in Cleveland. Well, in Zhuhai, we had what I call typhoon days, where a typhoon was coming through, so we were told to stay home. And then after the typhoon, there's always a lot of rain, so then we also had to deal with flooding. Someone actually took a picture of me in my car, because my driver chose to drive through this and stalled the van out. So we were stuck there for a while until they brought in like this big tour bus that could actually navigate. This was actually a road. It looks like a river, but we actually had to navigate that. And then, hopefully people aren't too grossed out by this one, I had some interesting roommates. They were big. It's hot and humid, and these guys were everywhere. So, all right. So in terms of some of the challenges, in this time frame, like March to June, the plant was actually starting to do production. But my QA lab was not ready at that time. So we set up some at the temporary university location. We also used a little bit of space in the maintenance building that we could set up. But then we told the construction guys, all right, let's prioritize. Let's build this temporary wall around where the QA needs to be and just focus on building this part ready getting that ready first. We'll get the QA lab set up, and then we can worry about the rest of the lab. That was not the original plan. The original plan was to get everything ready and done it at one time. But because we were so delayed, we had to find a creative solution, and it actually worked. Because then the QA moved in June, and you can see the plywood wall here. So while they're doing their lab tests, we heard all this banging and rust going on the other side of the wall. And then like a couple months later, then we actually moved the tech service lab out of the university into the snow location.
Did Lubrizol have any oversight? Did you use any resources from corporate?
Yes. Yeah, we had a whole set of expats that were involved with guiding the whole part of all the aspects of the construction. Yeah.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
All right, so then we actually had our ribbon cutting ceremony. This coincided with also when we opened the plant. And you can see we were adding more people during this time as well. And then you can see here's the finished product. So from mud to a two-story lab. We focus mostly on the first floor. The second floor right now is still open for future projects and things. And you can see credit to the team because they actually moved the lab. They continued to grow and add capabilities and also kept the business running with what they were doing. So really hardworking team to be able to do all that. And I said for a lot of people, they've never really experienced doing all three at the same time. This year, got a few more recruits to run the 10K, and what was interesting, it was raining, and so I actually saw some people running with umbrellas, and some guys were so nice that they would run with an umbrella holding it over their girlfriends or their wives. And I said, I don't think my husband would do that. All right, so the following year is the year of the horse. Any horse? Okay, Nancy is. All right. So just to kind of give you a sense of the layout here, this is where the QA testing was, and so we actually had the wall here. This part was then what we moved from the university, and then we had the new space to add in new capabilities. And then the last part of the project was finishing off what we call the large blend room in the warehouse. So that allowed us to actually make samples for customers or to support field trials. And so that was the second project or second phase after we moved in. And you can see, okay, here's my two-story warehouse that I needed that fire system to be up way up high, and then a lot of, you know, plumbing and things like that. So it was a complicated project. It took us about 10 months to get that completed, but we got that set up. So the lab's got all the capabilities that it needs at this point. But then the challenge I had from some of the customers, especially our internal people, that they were used to sending the work to the other locations. Now we're saying, okay, lab's open, use Zhuhai. And they said, well, you're not running as efficiently, or you're not setting up these tests as quickly as the other locations. I'm like, hold on, all right. There's some challenges. And if you're gonna buy equipment or set up anything in China, it's challenging, because if you're adding instrument capabilities, they do have Chinese equivalent of tests, but the quality may not be the same. And it was critical for us to make sure that we ran the tests the same way as the other locations, that you get the same results. So we had to order and buy Western equipment. But if you're importing equipment, realize it's going to cost you at least 2 to 3 times the cost. So whenever I budgeted, if they said, okay, it costs $10,000 in Wycliffe or in the US, I would add triple it and say, okay, it's going to cost us $30,000 to get it into China. You also have a time to ship. So maybe it's easy to get it in 3 months in the US. By the time you actually get out through all the paperwork and stuff, it could be anywhere 6 to 8 months. So that takes a long time too to get it through all the systems. I found out the hard way, it's impossible to really actually import certain things. So we had these syringes for a certain oxidation test. And in Chinese customs, they said, no, it's medical equipment. You can't import these syringes. So they turned around and went back. And it's like, I can't run the test without these, right? So we had to find another way to get those. And then also a reference. We had a special gasoline additive, or gasoline reference, that they said, there's only 3 government-owned companies that can import gasoline. You can't import gasoline. And then they said, and the quantities that you're, because we only needed about 5 gallons, and these companies were, you know, importing bulk quantities, and they said, you can't do it. So we didn't actually run that test, or were able to set it up, because we didn't have that key reference to get that test calibrated. Should have found that out in advance before we actually went through that whole process. It was down at the back end, and I think we learned our lesson that make sure all your consumables can be imported before you set up anything. And then drug chemicals. So acetone, right? Who wears nail polish, right? You use acetone on your nails. And chloroform, toluene, you use those pretty openly in the lab here, as well as in universities and other locations in the US. Well, in China, they're deemed as drug chemicals. So what we had to do was we had to go and get a permit from the police station. We also had to report how much we planned to use, and also report monthly what we actually used. And you had to have a special cabinet with a lock on it that you would say we were storing everything. And you had to have a live camera streaming on that lock cabinet that went back to the police station. So all these things that we had to do to set up, there was one simple solvent, I think it was a toluene. It took us months before we figured out, well, the things we had to do to get that permitting in place before we actually use the solvent. And then just, I think, you know, every company has their processes and things like that. I mean, SAP shipping is a big one for Lubrizol, but then I have to make sure that that's set up in accordance and is aligned with Chinese shipping regulations. So it's trying to find that middle ground and also make sure that our processes can work within the Chinese system. And that's still ongoing right now. All right, so everybody's finished lunch. Let's talk about food. So one of the big traditions in southern China is what's called morning tea. Also in here, I think locally, you can see here referred to as dim sum or small eats. And you get a lot of little dishes. It's kind of like a brunch. Everybody gets together and samples dishes and gets do some team building, or we will go for a hike afterwards. Now, one of the unwritten job responsibilities, if you're one of the senior people at the dinners, is that you get to pick the meal selections. The first time I went over there, it's like, well, what do you want to order? I'm like, why are you looking at me? I'm new here, right? No, you have to figure out what you're going to order for the rest of the team to eat. So what's swimming in these tanks, whether it's the fish or the shrimp, that's going to end up on your table. And then there's this big poster board here that has the sides, like other meats, vegetables, and also the rice or noodles. You also have to pick that. So the advantage is you get to pick things you like to eat. And also, I think credit to the team that they never complained about anything that I chose for them, too. They ate everything. All right, so here I have a little disclaimer. You can't go to China without talking about some unusual things that you've eaten. So the first slide is something that I've actually sampled. And if you can guess, I think most people have seen this. I don't know if people recognize this or this. So I told my husband, I said, I ate Daffy Duck from head to toe. This was actually very tasty. And then fish lips is the jawbone of the fish. There's a lot of cartilage. It's very, depending on what they cook it in, it's very tasty. All right, the next slide are things that I did not have the guts to try. See if you can guess. So you have dried mouse and a preserved pig head that I saw in the Shanghai commission. So I showed this photo of the mouse to my dad, and he grew up in the country, and he goes, oh yeah, dried mouse. I ate that when I was a boy. He goes, it's very tasty. I said, I'll take your word for it, Dad. All right. So we finished that year. You can see the schedule, the lab's starting to operate more. We're doing more things. This year was when we decided to run the half marathon. So we progressed to running a half. We got more people running. And I remember referring this one that around mile 8, I noticed the guy next to me stopped to take a walk break. He unzipped his fanny pack and pulled out cigarettes and took a smoke break, too. So that was unusual as well. So, all right. Last year was the year of what we call you the ram, sheep, or goats. So we have any, okay, more sheep and goats here. Okay. All right, so then the challenge, and I show you this one because I had what I call the three-year itch. And I mentioned the job hopping's common, right? So if I started the lab in 2012, we hit the three-year mark. I lost three people out of my 10 permanents, so almost a third of the employees. And so one of the key things to consider is making sure that you have employee retention or some way of making you sure that you handle that. So I spent last year trying to put in together a career plan, career ladders, so that people saw where they could progress. Yes?
What's the motive for them leaving?
Job opportunities. I think it's slowing because the rate of growth is slowing, but a lot of times you can get a change in title. That's one that was always critical when you talk to people, saying, I want a change in title. I can't be research chemist 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 over the next, my career. I want to see research chemist. I want to go to then research scientist. I want to be a senior scientist. They want to show that to family and friends that that's important. That's part of their titles. Yeah. Another thing we learned too was then that, you know, onboarding. Don't waste a lot of time trying to, you know, find a way to onboard people quickly, because if it takes you 3 years to get someone up to speed, you're going to lose them, right? So key is to try and do as much as you can the first year.
Were you seeing the people leaving, were they staying in the same geographic area, or were they
no,
going anywhere?
They were going anywhere. I mean, that's the challenge with Zhuhai. It's considered a third tier city, so it's hard for us to compete with like the Shanghais or Beijing, because that's where everybody wants to go. That's where a lot of the better schools are, so that's a challenge as well. Yeah.
Why did you pick where you picked that?
Because we were building a plant at that time, so that's why it would make sense for us to have the space there. We did look at other locations, and that's a challenge as well, because Shanghai, you know, the property value is very expensive, so it was a challenge to figure out where we were going to do that. If we're going to build a lab.
Do you still maintain a relationship with that university to bring in talent?
Yes, we still have the co-op or student programs, right? Yeah. So that's one thing to keep in mind in terms of recruitment. And then you'll notice with some of the names, in terms of what the Chinese people will choose as their English names, I had a cookie, I had a green tea, also a lychee, One of my students wanted to be called Banana. I was going to tell her professionally don't do that. But and I also had one that was called Chance. So I think the only thing I was missing was like a main course or a salad, right? All right, so the last year was really where we were able to, I think, show our customers that we can do what we do elsewhere in China. And so we showed our global international companies we can do the testing, the supply, and all that. So that's been really critical. And we did a lot of tours and training for customers. Some of them said, we're thinking about building an R&D lab. Can we come to see your lab? Because we heard you have state of the art. So we had a lot of visitors coming to see what we learned from our construction best practices and things like that. All right, so you can't talk about customers without talking about what you do to entertain customers, which is what the white spirit or baijiu is. And you can see it's a very high alcohol content, anywhere from 30 to 55%. And price range goes with the quality. And you're drinking it in these small glasses, so, you know, typical shots. And so at my going away party, the team said, we're going to toast you. So custom is guest of honor gets toasted by all the attendees. So you can count, with the exception of my husband and my driver who was drinking tea, I probably had to do about 18 to 20 shots for a dinner, right? And if anybody's ever tasted baijiu, I think this is probably the best picture to describe it. It burns going down, and then if you kind of, you know, have acid reflux, it burns coming back up. So the other thing with entertainment then is another popular thing is karaoke TV or KTV. Who likes to sing? Karaoke? Maybe a couple? No? Okay. My first time, I'm like going in there and they said, oh, pick a song. You have to sing. Do you know this Chinese artist? You know, very popular in China. It's like none of them made it to the U.S. So we're scrolling through and then I say, oh, I see Rod Stewart. Wait a minute. I'm not going to sing Do You Think I'm Sexy to my coworkers. They scroll down some more. Oh, here's Madonna. Wait a minute. I'm not singing like a virgin. So quickly learned, I better learn a song in Mandarin and a song in Cantonese, and that way I had something to sing. And it was also a good way to practice my characters, because you see on the TV screen, it's all characters. So that was an interesting experience. All right, so travels, you know, went to Macau, you can walk across the border. Hong Kong is just a ferry boat a ride away. Also did a lot of business trips in Shanghai. My husband and I went to Guilin, which is a beautiful river scene, and that's actually on the back of the 20 RMB bill. Also Beijing, the key sites there. And then also we just did Xi'an in December, terracotta warriors. So if you can imagine, the picture doesn't do it justice, but this is the size of 6 football fields, which are filled with all these soldiers, terracotta soldiers, that were there to protect the emperor's tomb. It's a great location or great place to visit. And then on a personal note, this is my grandfather on my mom's side, Yu Ziwu, and he was a general in World War II, and he died in the Battle of Hanyang fighting the Japanese. And so my mom came over and took me up to see his gravesite in Shaoguan. It's about 2 hours north of Guangzhou, and he's actually recognized by the government as a war hero, and his gravesite's a memorial site. So it was nice to get a little bit of my personal history as well. All right, so the last piece, this is really bathroom humor, because if you do travel in China, you have to get used to the public restrooms, right? So here's an example of what we had at the university. So I don't know if anybody's used a squat toilet before, right? Okay. So at the college, they didn't put doors to their restrooms, right? We all have doors here. Well, it was open. It's a tropical environment, so you have lots of things flying around in there. And so I made the joke when I first got there that you walk in and there's like a cloud of mosquitoes in the bathroom stall. So you had to learn how to, what I say, squat and swat at the same time. And then I encountered one where you don't actually flush. So you have a trough with water, and when you're done, you pick up this plastic scoop and rinse. And then here's the one that's actually no flush, right? So similar to probably an outhouse or something where it's just this tile trough and you do business there. And then my husband found these photos for me when he was traveling, saying, Okay, so the men's urinals, I said, why do they have these signs there? And his only comment was, there are puddles, but I don't know what they are, right? So just be prepared. I guess the Western plumbing is not the same as what we're used to, and be able to adjust, right? So this is probably my last dinner. This is with both teams. This is both the QA and CTSL. Tech service, and really that point, you know, they are my family. We have spent so much time together, but I think what the Chinese culture is, once they know you, you are part of their family. If you're a stranger, yeah, you're just someone in their way, but when they know you, that they really take care of you, and you have a lifelong family relationship. The lab's running very well at this point, so it was easier for me to step away, and so I think the last piece of it then is what I'm going through now. So I'm in a new role. I've returned. So the thing is, if anybody's interested in an expat assignment, don't forget about the repatriation. There's a lot of adjustments. It's not like you just get off on the freeway and you're back home, because you're a different person now. You have different experiences. And so don't underestimate that as to how you need to adjust. The things that I'm wrestling with is being back in the corporate headquarters after being pretty autonomous for 4 years. U.S. culture, I wish our government would block all those negative ad campaigns, right, on the TV. And then life at home, because as I mentioned, my husband actually stayed here in Cleveland while I was over there. So we're adjusting to being back together full time. And credit really goes to him for allowing me to do this, because he had the tougher job of maintaining everything and keeping the house and everything going while I was off on this adventure. So the last piece is really about, if you want to be successful, I think it's really being flexible and adaptable to navigating the contrast. It's not just the US versus the China contrast, but even within China, there's differences. And this photo, I think, kind of depicts it. This is outside my apartment complex on the river, and I'm living in this nice, you know, fancy apartment, but you still have a guy living on the river. This is his home with his dogs and cats, eking out a living on the river. So in terms of, you know, we have more access to technology information, but you have the government still trying to block all that. You also have rapid growth and progress, but then you still have, you know, centuries of culture and tradition, and trying to find a way to merge it or figure a way to kind of navigate that. So in that, I would like to say thank you for your attention. And if you have any questions, be happy to answer them.
Okay. Curious, you mentioned the auspicious time and date for the groundbreaking. What sort of role did feng shui play in the design of the building?
It was all American and Western. I mean, we pretty much worked on the plan the beginning to kind of work that out. And most of it was more designed around the lab workflow efficiencies. But in terms of some of the other traditions of when we would actually do the groundbreaking, it was more about the numbers, like the times and the dates. Yeah. Now, I don't know if someone was complaining about my feng shui. That could have happened. But I think even like picking out the colors for the lab, you can see it was very Western colors, because the previous lab, the temporary lab, was chosen by a Chinese person. And they said, oh, you have to have a dark colored floor. And I said, no, I don't want that. You have to have dark shades. I said, no, that's not what is pleasing to my eye. But that was more of what they had considered was appropriate. But then when everybody came to visit the lab, they said, oh, this is a really nice design. It looks really nice. So it's, again, that balance of you want to be state of the art and Western, or you want to use traditional Chinese selections. Yeah. Yes, Nancy.
How different is it working as a woman in a higher level in the US versus working as a higher level person in China?
It wasn't that. I think the challenge I had was I was seen more as American. So, but I think the title helps a lot. I think I was called the doctor woman over there because of my title. And so sometimes you can use that to your advantage. The public relations or the government local authorities, they did have women in more senior positions, but still I think it was very dominated by men.
So, yeah. So the assumptions are based more on your status.
Yes.
Rather than your gender.
Yeah, yeah.
And I was a few minutes late, so I don't know if you talked about this at the beginning, but had you been to China before, and did you know much about your family history there?
I'd been to Hong Kong when I was 10. My parents took me there to visit an aunt that had lived there at the time. And so I had a little feel for, okay, you got to boil your water and things like that. In terms of the family history, what's interesting is that my parents don't talk very much about their time in China pre when they left. So as it was heading towards the Cultural Revolution, they didn't talk about that. And with me going back, it was a good opportunity to say, okay, why did you guys leave? Because they pretty much just kind of walked across the border, went over to Hong Kong with their papers, which was a no-no at the time in 57. And so it's slowly coming out a little bit as to why they left, but they don't talk about that. They talk about their very young years when they were children, but that time I think was so dark and despair that they wouldn't talk about it. I think it brings back some bad memories. So I kept on asking, why won't Dad come back? He goes, I'll get arrested. Like, really? Yeah.
Would he get arrested?
I don't know. See, that's the thing, that we don't know where the legacy or how much history gets retained. I think at the time he said he was being trained in the medical school to replace a professor, and then he jumped ship. So he felt, I think, that there's that still hanging over him. But I don't know. My mom came back and didn't have any problems. Yeah. Any other questions? Yeah.
So how much difference is the Mandarin from, you said all the dialects of Chinese? Like a whole different language?
It's very different. So someone speaking Cantonese, the person that only knows Mandarin cannot understand. So let me give you an example. All right. So Happy New Year, Gong Xi Fa Chai, right? And then Cantonese, that's Mandarin, so Cantonese is Gong Hei Fa Choi. So Cantonese is probably a little bit more like a German, where it's a little bit more guttural. And then Mandarin, according to my teacher, has more flow or sway to it. Yeah. So that's where some words may be a little bit similar, but then others, it's completely different. And that's why I think when I mixed my Cantonese with my Mandarin, it was a mess. Yeah. People would be laughing. Yeah.
How long have you been in the States?
I came back in December, so January is officially when I started my new role and working back in the States. Yeah. And they say with repatriation, expect that it could take a year to kind of get back.
I'm going to speak at case for the end of the year.
Okay.
I believe you were leaving.
Yeah.
At that time.
Right. Probably in between a quick trip. Right. Yeah. Yeah.
What's it like balancing a full work life and learning a new language? And do you have any tips and recommendations on being more successful?
Oh, I think it's a challenge, especially depending on the language. We spent all the memorizing. The nice thing when we were still building the lab, it was that all we worried about was construction. So I was able to take classes twice a week for like an hour or 2 hours, and then did a little bit of homework on the weekends. There's amazing, so many apps now that help you with the language as well. So I would recommend those, yeah. All right, so I want to say thank you for your attention and hope you enjoyed the presentation.
Yeah.
The Knowledge Exchange is a presentation of Lakeland Community College.